Is track two. Welcome, everybody. I'm Encrypted. I'm so glad you're joining us. We have got amazing speakers, and I am really very excited to get to introduce you to these two wonderful university students from India who are joining us to share their exciting adventures with dissecting Go and Rust binaries, Simran and Namita, who are part of two cybersecurity teams there who happen to do reverse engineering. So without any further ado, I would like to hand this talk over to Simran and Namita. Please enjoy.
Hello, everyone. So I'm Simran.
I'm Namita.
So we just go right into it. I'll be sharing my screen. So as Cheryl said, so we'll go directly into dissecting Go and Rust binaries. Already been introduced, so let's dig right into it. So we'll just divide the talk into two parts. I'll be taking Go reversing and Namita will be doing the Rust part. So we'll start off by looking at some of the features in Go that are prominent and why Go is being widely used, and then we'll take up a CTF style binary and then analyze it and look into the features and the Go routines, how they're working and the stack splits. And then we'll go into challenge solving. So Go has a lot of features, as we know, it's been widely used. So it, as we know, it's a high performance language. So it's really fast. It compiles really fast. It has high concurrency. So that means it has the efficiency to utilize the capabilities of the OS using Go routines. So it can have multiple threads running at the same time. It's easy to code. It's a mixture of C and Python when it comes to coding. It's statically typed. So that means that we don't have to worry about explicitly declaring the variables. And it can be done during the compile time. So this lets the compiler decide whether a given variable can perform the actions requested from it or not. Garbage collection, again, we don't have to worry about freeing up the pointers or the issue of dangling pointers. So it's all done using the garbage collection property. Looking from a security side point of view, it's a disadvantage for the attackers because it's a statically linked binary. So it results in large binaries. So the malware distribution is kind of hard. So statically linked binaries means that all the import libraries, functions, everything is present physically inside the binary itself. So it's a quite large binary. So for an advantage, it can help avoid malware detection because since some security products are not able to handle such large binaries, so they just overlook some of the parts of it. Another advantage for the attackers is that it can run on any systems without dependency issues since it's a statically linked binary. So let's look into a challenge. So it's a CTF style challenge. So we have a ELF binary, 64-bit, and it's a statically linked binary. So everything is inside of the file. So if we run it, it asks for a password and we just have to enter the correct password. So let's open up the binary. So I've opened up this binary in IDA. So the first thing I see is the number of functions. So since it's a statically linked binary, it has approximately 2000 functions inside of it. It has the runtime import library, runtime library functions, and the format library functions. And we see that it opens up to a function runtime RTO go, which is the actual main of the program. This is what invokes main.main. So main.main has the actual code or the actual code that we typed into it. So we'll see how it actually goes from runtime RTO go into the main.main. So this is the IDA view of runtime RTO go function. And we see that we have a CPU ID instruction. So this is basically what tells us the information about the processor. So if it depends on the RAX bits and how they are set, and it accordingly sets other bits. So it's like if EAX is zero or RAX zero, then it gives information about the vendor. And if it returns runtime is Intel, it sets it. If it's an Intel bank, if the processor is of Intel type. Other features that we see is that we see a lot of runtime functions. So runtime library is part of every Go program. So it implements a lot of features like garbage collection, concurrency, stack management, and other critical features. So the first one that we look into is a runtime argument. So it is used to analyze the arguments that are passed to the main function. So the arguments like argc and argv are stored into some variables. So the next interesting function is the runtime new proc, which actually initializes a new go routine. So in this case, it is actually preparing for the main routine. So main routine is the first go routine that actually runs. And then we have runtime mstart. So it is the one that starts the main routine. So it's inside this function that the actual main routine gets executed, which is our main.main. And then let's look into what our main.main actually consists of. So again, we have this main.main. We'll be looking into three parts of it. We have a stack growth mechanism going on here. And then we'll look into how parameters are passed into a simple print line function and how it's actually getting printed. And then we'll just dive right into the flag check function, or where we actually get the password for the binary. So stack growth mechanism is the mechanism that checks whether if our stack needs more space, and it allocates it dynamically. So how it does it is, in Go routines, Go routines are very lightweight threads that are managed by the Go runtime. So the Go runtime itself manages these stacks. So let's understand what stacks are. So runtime takes a conservative route, and it allocates a space for a fixed space for every Go routine. So it initializes, every Go routine has a initial size of 8 KB, and then it checks if a Go routine requires more space. So a new bigger stack is allocated twice the size, and the original stack content is copied onto the new one. How does it do it? So it does it using something called stack splits. So this is what makes a Go routine stack dynamically sized. So every function has a prologue and epilogue. So prologue checks whether the Go routine is running out of space, and if it's the case, it jumps to the epilogue. If the epilogue, on the other hand, triggers the growth machinery, stack growth machinery, and then jumps back to the epilogue. Looking into the prologue in detail, so we have move instruction. So it moves a TLS to CX. So TLS is basically a virtual register maintained by the runtime that holds a pointer to the current data structure that keeps track of that state of a Go routine. So we have the gstruct, which has our stack guard. So this stack guard it checks with the stack guard, and if it exceeds the stack guard, then it doubles up the space and goes to the epilogue where it triggers that mechanism. So here we have our move, which moves TLS to CX, and then it SP is our stack pointer. So it checks if our SP is less than the stack guard, then it jumps to the epilogue and invokes the stack growth mechanism. So this is what our stack looks like, that we have a stack that grows downward and we have a stack guard. So if SP becomes less than stack guard, then it moves on to the epilogue. Looking into the epilogue, it's straightforward. It calls into the runtime, which will do the actual work of growing the stack. It jumps back to the first instruction, which is the prologue, and it creates like a feedback loop for us. Function call. So next we'll be looking into the second part, which is our how function call is actually happening. So we look into the fprintline function. For this, we need to know two things, how function calls work in Go and how our interface is working. So function calls, it's pretty similar to C. It's implemented, it works the same way, but it is implemented different. So in C, we have RDI and RSI register where arguments are passed and then passed on to the function. But here in Go, all the arguments are pushed onto the stack. So arguments and return values are placed on the stack owned by the callers function. And the return value is pre-allocated to the space immediately after the argument area. So we have our function, we have our arguments, and above that, a space is allocated for the return values. So here, the callee function directly puts the values here, and then this is above the caller function's frame. Next, we have interfaces. So interfaces is a set of method or function signatures. So when a type provides definition for all these methods in the interface, it is set to implement the interface. So how it actually works is that we have a program here. We have some operand, which is the type here, and we have two functions, add and subtract. And this operand is a type for these two functions. We have an interface which actually calls these two functions. So, and this is, as we said, the type. So what is actually happening here is that operand is the type which is implementing add and subtract. And these add and subtract are part of this calculate interface. So it is said that this operand is implementing this interface calculate. So now we can go and look into how the function println is actually working. So a normal println function has arguments. IO writer, which is where it wants to write to, and an empty interface. So here, whatever the type is sent, it prints according. It can take any type, so it prints accordingly. So here we have in our Go assembly, we have this the same print line function as seen in the IDA. We have an STMP2 pointer which is moved to CX, and this CX is moved to onto a stack for temporary space. So CX gets the value of the string which is pointed to STMP2. So here we see that STMP2 is actually containing the string enter the password that we saw at the starting. And then we have our OS, then we look that we have our OS STDOut, which is where it's printing out to our STDOut, and it's moving to CX. So all these registers are then pushed onto stack. So SP8SP is basically the offset from the stack pointer where it's being pushed. And the next thing is that we have a interface here. So Go ITAB actually points to an interface which has the write method, because it's actually writing. So it will have the write method to it. And so DX actually gets the address of it, and then it's pushed onto the stack. So each interface actually has a type and a value. So here our type is actually a string, and then our value is the value here, the enter the password. Okay, so next we can now go into and actually see how our binary is actually working and what is actually inside the binary. It calls for a flag check function. So we see that I have cleaned the IDA code a bit so that it's clear to understand. So it from scanf, a scan line, it takes an input and it's passed to main flag check function. So here our input, we just had a pointer here and then we just pass it to this flag check function. So it's passed to this function as a slice. So slice has two parts. So it has the actual slice or the string, and the second part is the length of that string or the slice. Moving into the main flag check function, we have this, we have our stack growth mechanism that is part of every function. Then we have a while loop, which is actually, we have a while loop. So it points to the, so we have an index which runs up to the length of the input. So this length of the input was also passed as the argument to it using the slice. And then we have a function runtime instring and concat string. And each of these functions, these are runtime functions. So they are run during the, when the actual program is actually being run. And it has some arguments. So we'll see it in the Go assembly view. And then it basically has a check where it checks with the hard-coded string, and then it either prints good job or not yet. So this is in Go assembly. So we see first that this is the same function flag check. We see that we have a jump in here, where a loop in here, as we saw, which is the same while loop. It has AX, which is moved to I. So AX is this basically our index here, and I, which is actually, it's an object file, assembly file. So it'll have its symbols present already. And then we have an out, which is an empty string, because we ZORed it and we just push these values to these out strings. And then we see that it's actually comparing AX and BX. So BX actually contains the length of our input, because pass is the password that we have to enter. And since it was passed to this function as a slice, it points to the later offset. So it just points to the last byte, which contains the length. Then we see that we saw this same runtime instring function, and we have one argument is being passed. So what is happening here is that pass is our input and it's moved to CX. And then this instruction, what it does is basically takes one single character from our input and moves it to DX. And the same DX is ZORed with a value 33. And then it's being pushed onto the stack, which is taken by this instring. So what instring does is basically, it's a, from the Go source, this is the what the function of instring is. It basically converts a slice byte to a string, or to an its ASCII character. And once it does that, it moves on, and there is a concat string function. So here it just concatenates two strings. We have our out empty string, which we got from here. It has its pointer and length. And then, so the value that we got, the ASCII character that we got from here, is concatenated or appended to this out string. So the final output from this loop that comes out is that it's ZORed, and then it's ZORed with our input string. And then, so this is what the pseudocode of this part looks like, that it's, we have a string out. So it runs for I less than length of our input. And then we have runtime instring, which just converts into ASCII. So we have our input and ZORed, and then it just is being concatenated and just out string. The same function, the other part of it, or the later part of it, is that from here that we got our here after this jump instruction, this loop, we are comparing our input length with 18. So if it's 18, then it jumps to instruction 303. Here we move on to instruction 303. Here we see that our string that we got, the out string, is being compared to this hard-coded string and then being appended to this, pushed onto the stack. And then we are calling runtime mem equal. So what runtime mem equal does is it basically compares two strings, and if they are same, it returns a one. Once it does, if the two strings are equal, it will return a one. So here it's being compared, the return value is being compared to zero. If the strings are equal, it jumps to line, if it's zero, then it jumps to line 199, which is here. Otherwise it doesn't jump and it goes forward. So here we see that it's the same print line function, and it has the arguments that are being that will be printed. So we see we have STMP1, which actually points to not yet, and we have STMP0 here, which points to good job. So it will pass if these two strings are equal. So that's what we want. So this is what the pseudocode for this looks like, that we have we just an if statement, runtime m equal our output string, and this hard-coded string, it prints good job, otherwise it prints not yet. Summarizing the challenge that we saw, that we have an input is taken and passed to flag check as a slice. Then we have in flag check each byte from our input, which is ZOD with 0x21 inside a loop. So every character is being ZOD. And then we have the byte which is returned is converted to ASCII and then concatenated to an empty string out. Hence, what is happening in this challenge is a simple single byte ZOR implementation in Go, where our string is being ZORed with 0x21. So finally, our out string is compared with a hard-coded string, this hard-coded string. And if this is equal, then it prints good job. Otherwise, it prints not yet. So how did we get the flag? So simple Python program. We just have our hard-coded string in a for loop, ZOR it back with 0x21, and push it back to flag empty string. And then we get the flag. And if we pass the same thing to the binary, it gives good job. So that's about it from me. So I hope you had a little glimpse of the Go reversing part. So this is what the challenge source was actually all about. It had a main, it asked for enter the password, flag, it was passed to flag check. And in the flag check, it basically, you know, same for loop, it just ZORed with the value, and then actually if loop where it just checks. That's about it. So now Namita will be taking on with the Rust reversing part.
Okay, hello all. So I hope you can see my screen. So I will be continuing with the presentation on Rust reversing. So let's start from the top. So what is Rust? So Rust is a programming language, which is an open source system programming language that focuses mainly on three concepts, that is speed, memory safety, and concurrency. So this was originally designed by Graydon Hore at Mozilla Research Center. And so what else do we know is that this language is used by developers to develop many software applications like operating systems, browser components, game engines, etc. So Rust is a more innovative system level language. So creators produce this language with safety in mind. So they aimed to beat C++ by offering a more safer memory management while keeping the speed advantage. So when you consider the case of Rust and C++ comparison, it is apparent that writing in Rust will result in a more creation of a speedy application. Now, the first thing which you will be looking at when you start learning a program is it's Hello World. So this is the Hello World program of Rust. It has a concrete base of C or C++ with code blocks separated by curly brackets and control flow keywords. Now, next, we will take a look at the compiling of a Rust program. So the basic compilation includes a command called rustc, which will which we use to run the Rust binary and then Rust program and then get a binary, and then you just have to run the binary. But when it comes to a position where you have to include dependencies and libraries, that's when you use something called Cargo. So what is Cargo? It's a Rust build system and package manager, People use this tool to manage the Rust projects, like as it can handle a lot of tasks like building your code, downloading libraries needed, and then building those libraries. So you just have to run cargo new, and then you'll build the package. Then you will be able to compile it using cargo build or cargo run. And then you'll be able to find the binary in a target debug folder. Now, the first thing you should know when you start reversing a binary is its structure. So I am taking a basic Hello World program we just saw and then using its binary to understand a binary structure of Rust. So when you run the binary on IDA or GDB, you will get something like this. This is the assembly code. And at looking at this, it is almost similar to the libc start functions on a C binary. That is, here you can see that the main function address passed on to RDI. This is being passed on to RDI, which will be this hello main function call. So what we see here is fairly a simple function that loads a pointer to the other main function into RDI and passes that as an argument to this particular call, that is stdart lang start. So this function initializes the Rust runtime and calls our real main function. So a point we should know is that Rust has something called a fast call, where it passes the arguments to the function through just registers and not directly from stack. So as I told you, this is the actual function. So we look at the actual function. This is how the real main function, that is the function which contains the program we wrote, is there. So I'll open it in IDA to get the auto comments just for a clearer view. So here, it's just like a C binary, but what we can see here is that so Rust creates a stack frame and cleans it up at the beginning and end of every function. So here, unlike the source code with just a print statement that just prints a string, that's hello world, we can see two function calls. That's arguments and another is print. So why is this happening? Is to understand that you have to know something, another concept called macros. So what are macros? The term macros refers to a family of features in Rust. It is designed to give a variety of really useful shortcuts for avoiding the pain implementing basic functions. And it has an exclamation mark at the end of the function, the macro, so you'll identify it as a macro. And Rust already provides 30 macros. So these are a few examples that Rust provides, the macros Rust provides. So from this, we can identify that println is actually a macro. It prints to standard output with a new line, and it is a macro implemented in the Rust standard library, and the module it uses is stdfmt. So in order for you to see it not through a binary, cargo can help you by using the cargo expand command. Where if you take the code, then you'll be able to see the expanded version of whatever macros is being used in that code. So here I have just did it in the hello world, and you can see the call of the first argument new v1 we saw, and then that is being passed as an argument to print. So this is basically how macros works. So that's how the other binary had two function calls. Now, next, we'll look upon how Rust uses memory. So we know that there are two concepts, that is stack and heap, in every memory. So the stack in Rust is where the memory is being allocated by default. But the allocation is local to a function call and is limited in size. The heap, on the other hand, is slower and explicitly allocated by the program. But it's effectively unlimited in size and is globally accessible. So in the case of Rust, any data of fixed size or known size, such as an int or float, is being directly stored in the stack. It can also include pointers. Dynamic and unsized data is stored on the heap. So this is because often these type of unknown size data can expand, dynamically grow. So that's why it is being occupied inside a heap. Now, moving in detail to a stack frame. Stack records everything that occurs on the program. So the main method is first performed and then it is added to the stack. Every function we meet is added to the stack together with the variables and values declared on that function, resulting in the creation of a scope system. So when another point is that there is no need of garbage collector. Now, why is that? When a function is executed, the relevant variables and values stored on that stack are discarded. So this results in clearing up of the memory resource collected. So that means there is no need of a garbage collector. As we know, garbage collectors are a system where that is being provided by the compiler that automatically detects any free space which is no longer in use. Now, another point I have to bring is that suppose we have a large data of vectors in heap and have reference to it in the stack. If I want to copy a collection of data stored on that vector to a new variable, copying the data might take up a whole lot of memory. So what Rust does is Rust sometimes copies the pointer, that is the memory reference. This can lead to something called a dangling pointer issue, where two pointers will be pointing to the same position. Now that's when a concept called ownership pops up. Ownership has basically few rules. That is, each value in Rust has a variable that is called its owner. There can only be one owner at a time, and when the owner goes out of scope, the value will be dropped. Now, even then, it is very inconvenient to pass the ownership of a variable to another function and then return to the return that ownership. So Rust brings another concept called borrowing, where the ownership of a value is being transferred temporarily to an entity and then returned to the original owner. So this is done by passing a reference to a variable. Now let's look at a basic challenge solving, where you'll be given a binary, its name is binary, and then you have to enter the flag, and if it's right, they'll print it. So as I have already covered the part where there are two mains and all, we will directly go into the actual main of this function. So this is the IDA view of our function, the IDA view of our particular challenge. So going in close, I can see a lot of calls of strings, new arguments, new even, print, std, in, read line, etc. So in order to understand this, I will have to go through the important function so that we can understand the function call. So the first few functions are strings, new, println, readline, and core result unwrap. First one is strings new. So string new is basic code in Rust where you initialize a string. So here what happens is when I call the string new, there happens place where the stack, whatever was there in this particular position, that RSP plus 0x20, that will be 32. This is being passed on to RDI. And as I told, the registers represent the arguments. So the same thing is coming up at the arguments of that call function. So this is basically some address of a variable that is being used. Now, next one, we will be looking at the print statement that we have already covered how it works, but it we can see what all arguments are being passed on to that. So a print statement consists of argument, new variable, and a print function call. So here, as we can see here, when we call this argument new event, there are basically four arguments, but we don't know what it is printing. So going further, we can see that there is a print call that is being happening here. This print is being, the address is being passed into RAX and RAX is being called. So when I move on to that particular call RAX, we can see that the only argument passed is enter the flag. So from that we can identify what exactly it's getting printed, and that is from the stack. As you can see here, the arguments was being passed from the stack. Now the next function is readline. So readline is basically to input data from the user. So here I can show you that the same thing is happening. That is, RCX has the address and this is called in RCX. So when that happens, basically we give the input, and then after giving the input, you can see that the input I gave was flag IDK, and this was directly pushed onto the stack. So that's how readline works. Now, the next one we have is result unwrap. Now what it is, we have to understand. To understand that, you have to know a few concepts. So we'll move on to that. So here, there are basically two important factors you should know about before moving on to that function called core option and core result. So what is core is that it's a Rust library, which is a dependency-free foundation of Rust standard libraries. So option and result are generic enums. So when what it is that here, generic enum of option is a generic enum which can either have some value or no value. Result is a generic enum which is used if functions can produce error or success. Now, when is this used is the next question. So if an output, that is any return of a function, if it can be empty, then that's when option is being used. Now, result is being used when there is chance that an error can occur. So this is not how directly it can come into a program, but there are functions that use this. So one of the function is what we have used in our code, that is unwrap. So unwrap, basically what it does is when it is called on a result, unwrap will return the value if one exists and will panic if it does not. And if it's called on option, then it will give some value if there is a value, or it will give panic if there is no value. So it's basically a system where the user, the programmer have to include that in the code so that the any kind of issues can be avoided, like any kind of memory issues, or it's just making the program safer. So Rust actually uses that. So that's how unwrap is used. So for our code, Rust was being used with result. So that means, and the function that was just above it, it might have needed unwrap. We called readline. So it was being called with readline. That means it had a chance of having an error at all if something happens. So that's why result unwrap was called. Now the next function we'll be encountering is the function one, which is being shown here. So function one, when we call function one, there are basically two arguments that is being passed. First is some address. Second is flag IDK, that is the input we gave. Now let's see what happens inside. Now this is the description of, this is the pseudocode of our function one. It also have a lot of function calls. So let's just pick up important ones. So the first one we'll be looking at is core panicking. Now, what is core panicking is? It's a module of core library, which is core panicking, which is using panic function. Panicking is a core part of the Rust language, and it is used to allow the program to terminate immediately. So when is this used? Is in our pseudocode, you can see that this is one of the parts where core panicking was used. Here it is written, if not V12, then it is calling core panicking. Now, this module, it gets used to generate a panic and start unwinding its stack. So why it is used is that it's basically for safety reasons. That is, when there happens an attempt to operate on invalid data, it can expose your code to vulnerabilities. So this is the main reason why there is a panic call. So this is basically done by the compiler. So for the unwinding of stack, if at all something goes wrong, it's just making sure that memory is safely unwinded. The stack is unwinded. So this is not something we can I have included in the program. This is something that the compiler does it on its own. Now, the next part, so we can see a lot of positions where panic is being used. Here it is used. Then this here also it is called. So these are some positions where the compiler felt the need of panicking. Now, the next function is truncate. So truncate was basically used to shorten a string down to a number of characters passed as a parameter. So the input is being passed, and whatever they needed to shorten, that's also passed as an argument. The next two important ones are core OPS deref and core OPS index. Now, where is it used? Is that in our code itself, you can see here, and these are the positions where those are being called. Now, let's see what they are. Core OPS deref, it's an immutable dereferencing operation. That is, it is called for a smart pointer, making the access of data behind them more convenient. So it was being called after truncate. So basically, it should have been for calling, using it for the truncate function. The next one is core OPS index. This is being used for indexing operation, and it can also be used in mutable operations where it is written as index mute. So that's why there has been a use of index and OPS deref. Here, index is being used in the loop. So basically, it's just indexing. The next one is collect and cars. Now, what are they? And where are they used? So here you can see that chars and collect are being used, are being called together. So looking into it, collect function, it iterates over a string one by one. And this is usually used to collect values from a string to move into the vectors. So this is where that function call is being used. Now the second one is chars. An iterator over the chars of string slice. So this is being together used to convert the string into the vector, as this pseudocode explains. Now the last part is the loop, where you have operations happening. So the indexing happens at here. It calls the index function, and here the first argument that is being passed is the first element of our string input. So that is clear. Now, where does the operation happen? Is here you can see that XORing and adding is being happening with ECX. And ECX contains the first element F. And so we can identify that XORing and adding are the major two operations that happens in our code. So that is over. So next, we will be looking at the last function, that is EQ. Now, EQ is being used at this particular location that is outside of our function, that is at the main function. Here, I can see that core CMP partial EQ is being used, and there is a string also. So basically, we can understand that it is just comparing string. So when you call that function, here the flag which I gave, which they zored and added, that and the flag which is hard-coded, that is being, I mean, the string which is hard-coded is being compared. That's what is happening here. Now, this is the final check of our code, where if it is, if an else statement is there, if the comparison is right, then you will be moving on to this particular location. Now, what that is if you look, it is a address to the offset, which prints this. That is great, you got the flag. And if it is not, then try again, will be printed. That is this address. So from that, we have used our reversing skills to just reverse the hard-coded string we got. And then from that, we will be able to get our flag. So this is the challenge source of our program, which we have used in the binary. First, we entered the flag, read line is happening, function is being called, and whatever being outputted from that function is being compared with the static string. And then it prints if it's correct or not. So concluding, both of the languages, that is Go and Rust, are among the youngest languages which are being used so widely. It was born out of a need to provide a safe and scalable solution to the problem impacting the software development. And this calls that can be start digging into these languages and learn to reverse engineer programs built in these languages from a security perspective. So that is the end of our talk. Thank you.
I hope that I enjoyed.
Thank you both very, very much. That was an excellent presentation, and I think we came away the richer for it. This is recorded. You shared your Twitter in the feed. Again, thank you so much for being a part of Dian Initiative this year. And
thank you.
I hope you get to go and enjoy all of the great things. And this is encouraging our attendees as well. Please go visit our expo hall. There's tons of great things in there with our sponsors and a great chance for you to meet them. You never know what you'll come away with. We've also got Capture the Flag, where you could perhaps use some of the really interesting tidbits shared here today to win those flags. And we've also got Career Village. And after Alyssa's really inspiring talk this morning, set your sights high. You are worth every penny you ask for and every opportunity that is out there. So Simran, Namita, it is an honor. Thank you so much for sharing what you have today.
Thank you.
Okay. I will turn the stage back over and let you guys get on your way.
Yes.